You can't make other people happy, and you can't make people unhappy. And when you try, the more you try, come on, let's have fun. After a while, you're like, you better get out of my face. It doesn't work. But you know what does work? Is to complain and commiserate with people. When somebody walks around, they're having a bad day, you got to be tight. You got to be in tight. Anybody here tight? They got a friend that they can do this with, that they can go there with them? They're having a bad day, and you can kind of say to them, yeah, you having one of those days. And just kind of laugh a little bit. You're having a bad day. But you know what? You know, thank God you're having a bad day, because you'd be miserable if you just walked around telling me how good it was all the time. You know, I'm right here complaining with you. We'll be like Thelma and Louise. You know, we'll just me and you. We'll be complaining. After a while, you just start realizing, hey, your mood is lifting in kind of talking about the things that are bothering you. And you're sitting there thinking, after a while, you know, all I need is an old convertible and a cliff. We'll really, you know, we're just, but you're doing it together. And you cannot go through life alone. Because when you look at the value of you, there are other people around you that have the same value to contribute. But if we act like caregivers, where this is my responsibility to take care of other people, and I don't need this, I got this, I'm good, we're creating, without a doubt, a scenario where we're going to fall and that we're going to fail. So while you value, very obviously, what you can do for other people, you don't truly value what is important about that and what makes that valuable, and it's you. It is the absolute value of you. And, you know, when this thing about, oh, I'm just doing my job. I'm just doing my job. We got to stop that. You got to celebrate. You got to take credit. You got to be proud. Be proud or be killed. Think about it. You're killing yourself a little bit inside. But even worse than that, this drives me crazy. Let's think about this. Stick with me on this. I've never said this out loud. I actually thought of this on the drive over here. And I said, this is amazing. This is amazing. This is how it happens, folks. You get an idea and you share it. I want you to be proud, because I don't want you to die. I don't want you to kill yourself, and I don't want you to get killed off. If this was this is an ALF, right, an assisted living facility. Let's just think for a minute that this was the ALF of horrors. You know what happens in horror films? The first people to die are those little meek girls that just goof around and are like, oh, shucks, you know. They're flirting with them. And then the two of them, they just walk off, you know. They walk off and they're laughing like, oh, Ethan, my blouse is cute, you know. And you're like, oh, not me. Well, they get killed right away. First one to get killed in the horror movie. First one to get killed. Now think about this. Because the one that's always going around, look at me, I'm this. They're always there. They stay in the movie till about three quarters of the way through. Eventually they get theirs. But you know what happens? First it's the people that won't take credit. Then it's the people that are nice. The next one that gets killed is the big dumb jock. Do anything you want, you know. You know, like the big guy on 311 shift, you get him to help you pick all the patients up. You know, he's happy and friendly, he'll do whatever you want. He'd be next in the horror film. Then finally they'll get to this nuisance, this one going around to take credit. So you wanna take credit. You at least survive the shift a little bit further. Because think about this. This is undeniable in this horror film. It's first the little shy ones, they're gone, and then it's the big happy-go-lucky ones, and then it's the irritating ones. And who always survives? Because the horror film is always shot from the perspective of the newcomer. She doesn't know any of the people. And at the end of the movie, they're always the ones still standing. Now, is that the way it is in your building? Are you going to leave the new people to be in charge? No, step up and take credit for what you do, but do it in a kind way. Not only be kind to you, be kind to them. Because you know what CNA really stands for? Take a crack at it. Certified nursing assistant, right? Cannibals in need of attention. If you do not take a moment to celebrate what you do and to celebrate what the others around you do, you will, whether you know it or not. If you finally get the attention, you'll deflect it. If you finally get an award, you'll be like, oh, I don't deserve this. I'm just doing my job. But day in and day out praise, you'll absorb without even knowing it. Get good at that. Get good at that for each other. Because cannibals needing attention is a very real scenario when they are taken for granted. They are not brought involved in events and planning and solving, problem solving. CNAs suffer the same plight a lot of times in an environment or in a business culture or workplace environment that our Youth of America do. They get taken for granted. They get taken for granted. Now, some of the people in this room that have asked me to speak have heard me say this before. I want you to try and visualize turning your place upside down and letting your CNAs be in charge and give you some ideas about what's going on and how things should happen. Now, they can't go crazy and be irresponsible with it, but the insight will be amazing. It's just like the youth is amazing. You know, when you go to the youth out there and they want an opportunity to do something, they have ways of solving problems that you're just now finding exist. They already know how to solve them, and we never listen to them. We yell at them for using their cell phone or something like that when they're using their cell phone to solve the problem. They've already filled 3 to 11 shift with their cell phone before you've even had a chance to go to your office and start calling. And you know why they've done that? Not because they love you and want you to have a good evening, because they're trying to go to a dance or a movie that night and they want to make sure it's covered. They're going to get it covered with their cell phone before even, you know. Yet what we do in our industry is we see people with a cell phone and we say, oh, that's wrong. We have to eliminate that. Cell phones are, and then we have a zero tolerance policy for cell phones. And then we have our best CNA get caught with their cell phone. What do we do then? Oh, well, she's one of the good ones, so we'll ignore that policy today. Exception. But we got the bad one. You know, people aren't good and bad, but we got the other one. Oh, well, we're going to enforce the policy on that one. So you're losing your own credibility. But the issue, folks, whichever side of this cell phone you're on, is one of respect. And even though it is very hard to put down a cell phone, because you do, they have measured it, you get a little surge of endorphins when you get a text. It's a connection to the world, a connection to your loved ones. They've measured it. I've gotten to the point where I grow irritated by it because it's something I have to pay attention to and respond to. But they've measured it. It's very natural. But it is, if you handle a cell phone like more of an issue of common courtesy than of policy, you're going to get a lot further with it. But it has to apply to everybody. I need to drink something here for a second. One of the other reasons that I really want you to understand the value of you is you're such brave people. And you dismiss that bravery. I spoke to a primary care group in Virginia not too long ago. And I went to dinner with them beforehand. And I was going to go out and do my caregiver stuff about how wonderful everybody is. And they're phenomenal. And they've got these unbelievable hearts. And they just need to be sort of comforted and put in a positive environment. And what I found when I was at dinner was the people that owned and operated these organizations were really very mad at their caregivers. They respected and appreciated what they did, but they did not appreciate some of the dilemmas and circumstances that they were put in, and some of the things that they did out there in the field. And then I also listened and I said, you know, we give them 24 hours of training. You know, I'm thinking, okay, so you're hiring somebody who's not even a CNA. Not had the training that people have. And you give them 24 hours of training and then you put them in people's homes and you expect everything to go okay. I mean, you guys do amazing things. You're out there dealing with situations. You don't know what's coming at you, who's coming at you. And it's not as easy as you think. Like, I remember how at times in my life, I'm a little intimidated by meeting other people. I remember vividly the first time, my first fist bump. You know what I'm talking about, your fist bump? Yeah, you know, go up, you shake somebody's hand or what have you. And this guy came up to me and went like that for a fist bump. I'm like, you know, I'm going to get it. And then I realized, no, he didn't want to fight. You know, I guess maybe he wanted to play. So he put that out, and I just covered it, you know, with paper. I'm like, because I know, you know, you give me rock, I'm showing you paper. Yeah. And for some of you smart Alex out there, I got the scissors waiting for you right here. Booyah. So, but you're meeting people, you're dealing with situations, and you're responding to them in real time by yourself, relying on yourself, relying entirely on yourself. Let's talk a little bit more about this Heart's Eye logo, because the center of it, I call this AAA protection. Awareness, acceptance, allowance. Do you know that there's a huge issue going on in the public, in the private sector? Do you know that the amount of caregiving that goes on in homes, is 10 times, if it was compensated, if it was paid for, even at the lowest wage, it is roughly 10 times the value of what is paid for and the expense of the entire long-term care industry. It is a huge, huge industry. And these folks do not accept help. Anybody here work in admissions here in the buildings? Do you know by any chance, some buildings track it, some don't, some are blessed, some struggle. Do you know how long it is from the first inquiry to actually coming into a room, your the length of time, your close ratios? Some big companies follow that, some don't.
It depends on the situation. It could take a week, it could take 6 weeks.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and a lot of times it has to do with the acuity of the situation. You know, if it's evolving, like a slow evolving dementia or what have you, then it might take 8 months from them first inquiring to finally making the decision to coming in. I mean, you know, it's a long process, but between doing this, and part of the reason is because it is not in the nature of the caregiver. As a matter of fact, it is totally opposite of the nature of the caregiver to accept help. And this is a problem. Caregivers are, you know, 3 to 5 times more likely to suffer from depression. Caregivers make 20 to 30% less on their annual income than people that are not being in the caregiver role. Caregivers frequently, through a secondary illness type of thing, end up having more stress and more medical problems than the loved one they're caring for. And the big problem is that there are professional organizations that are out there that are ready to provide services to help with a lot of these problems. There's respite services, there's grants, there's money. I mean, it's not like you just dial the phone and a bunch of people are going to show up at your house and solve all your problems. But you know what? Probably more than you realize could be available to you if you would reach out and ask. Now, I know we're a little off subject because we're talking about an assisted living, you know, environment here. But the people that you are providing services to for a very long time don't want your services. And then when they do accept your services, they feel guilty about it. They feel like they've done something wrong, something unnatural. I have a friend of mine, one of my man crushes for a long time. His wife, he's been married forever, and he's a people person. He doesn't do well without people. So his wife would go on a camping trip twice a year, every year. And Scott is his name. Scott would date me while she was gone. I would have to, you know, fill the void for Scott. And his wife, he calls her Rufus. And when I first met Scott, I'm like, why won't you go home? What's going on here? And he goes, no, Rufus is camping with Mike. And I'm like, Rufus is camping. Yeah, Rufus camps with Mike twice a year, every year for a weekend. And I'm like, okay, you got a really liberal, open marriage, you know. Well, it turns out Mike is a woman, so I got past all that. But Scott could not be alone. And Scott would spend all of his time with me. And the first weekend it happened, it was amazing. I'll shorten the story, but he just wouldn't go away. And we were chopping wood because we both have fireplaces, and he knew some wood. We'd go get the wood, and we could split it, and we could stack it. I'm like, yeah, it's a great day, Scott. You know, great day. We did this all day. And then at the end of the day, when we're driving by his house, I drop him off, and he goes, wait a minute, hold on for a minute. And he comes out, and he hands me a sirloin and some frozen asparagus. We live, you know, very short walk away. He goes, put it on the grill. I'll grab a box of wine, be up there in a little while. So I cook dinner for Scott. The next day we go out and we do the same thing. We're going around and running. And then he tells me, he goes, Rufus is getting home later today, but we're going to have pork chops this afternoon. You know, he's telling me all this stuff. And then, so I drop him off and he goes, and I said, Scott, I gotta run some errands. I gotta do something. I got all these things I had to do. I just need an hour. I'll be back. He goes, all right, good. We're going to have pork chops. So about 35 minutes into this, I'm starting to get hungry. I'm thinking, you know, eat those pork chops. I'm going to get something out of this whole deal. He calls me. He goes, you know, Rufus got home. You know, she came home early. So we're popping the tent. We're cleaning it out. We're doing all this stuff. We're getting ready. He goes, all right, man, I'll see you. And it dawned on me, you know, what about my pork chops? You know, I'm not getting them. But, you know, he's a people person. You know, he wants to, you know, these people are put on this planet naturally this way. But here's the challenge. When you are put in a situation, you're either born, naturally born, or born with an E by accepting a burden or responsibility. If you've learned how to be this way and you still have to be this way, either way, it's very hard to step out of it and ask for help. This awareness, acceptance, allowance is something that I've created up to try and break this down. Now, many of you may have picked it up. It's called The Caregiver's Vow. On YouTube, if you do a search for Caregiver's Vow, I think there's 26 of them. They're 2-minute videos, and they're me being funny, but talking about these things and then finishing with The Caregiver's Vow to walk you through awareness, acceptance, and allowance. I absolutely want you to learn this because it is a wonderful tool to allow you to let go of the guilt. When you are caring for somebody, whether it be nature or nurture, or because you choose it or because it chose you, it is very hard to not step into that role. Empathy. You realize they're in pain, they're suffering. Empathy. You might be a caregiver if, it all started with these statements. My first "you might be a caregiver if" statement was, you might be a caregiver if you can make life and death decisions with a snap of a finger, but you need 15 minutes with a dinner menu. Now the reason for that is you don't know how to please yourself after a while. So with the empathy, you might be a caregiver if, when you say, "I feel your pain," you mean, "I feel your pain." So you've got this empathy. So it creates guilt if you do nothing. You step in, you do something. You choose this profession, you care for your family, whatever. Here's one very important thing. It's got to be the end of guilt. The minute you accept that burden or responsibility, you have to let go of guilt. If not, you know, you're guilty. So to avoid the guilt, you fulfill the obligation. The minute you fulfill that obligation, you now have to let go of the guilt. It's a step. If you take on the obligation and the responsibility and you hold on to the guilt, you are automatically overloaded. It's supposed to be progression. Empathy, guilt, obligation. When you get to obligation, let go of guilt. If you don't, you're playing God. Guilt, obligation, depression. A harder D I'd like if I were to say that again. Depression. It's absolutely a guarantee. And folks that are in the caregiver role, they value you, they value themselves so much they don't think they need help. They won't accept it, whether it's professional or somebody else. And then at some point when they hit their tipping point, they'll look around and they say, "Nobody will help me." And everybody's like, "Yeah, because you've trained us to leave you alone. Every time we offer, you say no." I actually have another book coming out, How to Care for a Caregiver, as if you really cared. And the problem is, who would buy it? It's a fun, quick read. You would buy it? No, because caregiver... they're funny things like don't ask, tell, just say no, you know, stuff like that, you know, just do it. It's funny things, but they're very powerful things. Like helping a caregiver, you can't say, you know, "Let me know if I can help you," because they won't let you know. You have to see what they need. You have to anticipate. You have to do it. But here's a critical thing. Don't finish. Start, but don't finish is one of the tips. If you're going to help a caregiver, it drives me crazy now. When I have somebody come over and try and help me, they say, "Well, I'll just run the dishes for him," you know, and that's fine. You can run the dishes for me. I don't care how you load that dishwasher. I could get more in there if I did it, but you're doing all right. I don't care. But if you put my dishes away, we're going to have a war because you are not helping me. You are putting them places I don't know where they are. You're hiding them from me. Start but don't finish, things like that. But that'll be in there. I can't wait. I got to get that out. But really, who will buy it? Because the caregivers won't buy it for themselves. They won't spend a dime on themselves. And the people they're caring for are probably not in a position to buy it for themselves. And the family members really don't want the answer to this because they'll have to do something. So it comes to you. You have got to learn to take care of you. You have got to value yourself enough to take care of yourself. Let's do awareness, acceptance, allowance and see how easy it is. Now, I want you to know something as I go into this. When am I supposed to stop, by the way? Because I'll do this all day. 1:45, thereabouts. Okay, here's why this is important. Now, there is nothing wrong about this. This awareness, acceptance, allowance. It is not wrong. It's not a judgment. It's observations. You know, the first time I realized awareness, acceptance, allowance, the first time I became aware that I was getting old, you may have had this experience too. I became aware I was getting old when I could no longer tie my shoes without losing my balance. You know, I didn't have the core strength, the quad strength, the perception, so I was aware that I was getting old when I could not tie my shoes without losing my balance. So I sat on the bed to tie my shoes, and then I was aware that I was short because I couldn't reach my feet. Okay, right. So then I got up and I went to the couch, and then I became aware that I was fat because I still couldn't reach my feet. Okay? Okay? And then I became aware that I was out of shape because I was now too tired to tie my shoes. And then the real kicker was I realized I was broke because I couldn't afford to buy loafers so that I wouldn't have to tie my shoes, and I felt that I would be old, tired, fat, out of shape, walking around with untied shoes for the rest of my life. That's a moment of awareness. Okay? That's a moment of awareness. But here's how simple it is. There's nothing bad here. It's just an observation. Here's how simple it is. Here's acceptance. Okay, I'm old, fat, tired, and broke, and I'm going to be alone forever because only the tall, thin, wealthy men get, you know, to marry well. So I'm going through life my way like this. But here's something. Acceptance. You've got to accept the moment. So I'm old, tired, fat, out of shape, and broke. But so what? I'm funny as hell and full of life. You know what? That's right. That's right. That's right. That's right. Like I always say, I'm fat, I'm 50, but I'm fine. That's right. That's right. And now we go straight to allowance. I promise you, ladies, I'm fun and ready to go. If y'all want to go dance and have a good time, I will allow you to join me. I'm also going to have to allow you to buy dinner because I ain't got no money. If you'll allow me to dance with you, because I do have something to offer. Awareness, acceptance, allowance, it's such a simple path. See what's there. See what you got. See what you can do about it. And just move forward. Allow it to be okay. Allow other people to join you on that journey. Allow, look at all these people who could buy me dinner. I'll allow you to do that. It's such a simple thing. Have joy in the moment. Accept it along the way. You know what humor is? Humor is a healthy understanding of moments others recognize. Humor is a shared thing, true humor, not slipping on banana humor. You know, not Rob Dyrdek humor. You know who Rob Dyrdek is? Does these stupid YouTube videos. You know, it's humor is a healthy understanding of moments others recognize. Humor is shared. The last thing you learn when you go into a new culture or a new language is humor, because you have to understand what is going on a higher level. Laughing together is a wonderfully unifying moment. Don't ever deny it, but also don't ever abuse it. There is a difference between humor and joking around. There is a difference between fun and funny. It's about being available. You, in the moment, being available to have fun. Not going out of your way and trying to do it. You can't go around joking, ha ha ha, you're depressed, oh, forget about it. You know, you're demented, oh, don't worry, forget about it. You know, that's not, that's inappropriate. But being available to fun and realizing, I mean, I've had some incredible experiences in my career in nursing, things that I just don't even want to talk about, that in retrospect, I found humor in them. So don't be afraid of the fun in your career and as you go on. Now, I want to leave you with a couple of other things, and I want to leave you about this simple thing about awareness, acceptance, and allowance. It's so easy to get confused and think things are a lot more difficult than they are. Can you see this picture? Can you see this picture? This is a fitness center, and this is a guy with a towel because he's going to work up a big sweat. He's going to go work out, but in order to get there, he's going to ride the escalator. You know, and he would have been there earlier, but he had to circle the parking lot for about 5 minutes to find a parking space. You know, he had to get to the closest to the front. So this is how easy it is to complicate life. It's so easy. Awareness, acceptance, and allowance. This is no judgments. Just be aware. There's something called cognitive distortions, where when we are stressed, we think in negative ways and dysfunctional ways. I've had the audacity in my book and in all my teachings to call these caregiver distortions, because we've already acknowledged that whether it's nature or nurture, by desire or circumstance, if you are a caregiver, you are living vicariously through others. You are living a stressed life. You have distorted thinking. You cannot see yourself the way others see you, nor would you want to try. I think it would make you dizzy. But you have to rely on other people to help you see yourself how you are. Here's a quick lesson on a cognitive distortion. One of them called a should statements. You motivate yourself by saying, I should do this, I should do that. That's not motivation, folks, it's mutilation. It's punishment. Every time you say, I should do this, it's like going, whip, do it, do it, do it. I should do this, I should do that. Folks, caregivers have a shitty attitude. Because they think this is motivation, it's mutilation. Here's how you avoid it. I should go for a run. No, you shouldn't. It's called SAS. You put a should against should statements. Or a shouldn't against should statements. Bottom line is you argue the opposite. You find a compelling reason to accept the argument. You're free to do whatever you want. Here's how it works. I should go for a run. No, you shouldn't is the SAS commentary. Yes, I should. My weight's going up. My cholesterol's going up. Doctor tells me I need to get my waistline below this. My weight on that chart. Yeah, you can have those charts. But anyway, you know, so I should go for a run. The little voice, no, you shouldn't go for a run. And you say, okay, why shouldn't I go for a run? Well, did you know that roughly 50,000 people die every year while jogging? There's your one reason. And I think about 99.9% of them said, I should go for a run tonight. So if you want to live, don't go for a run tonight. It's simple. Now guess what you can do? You can go for a run tonight, or not. The guilt is gone, the stress is gone, the extra anxiety you put on yourself is gone. You're free to do whatever you do because you're not shooting all over yourself. Okay, this is very powerful because even if you go for a run that night or not, it doesn't matter because it matters what you're going to do the next night and the next night and the next night. If you're not going to do it like 20 out of the next 30 nights, that run doesn't do anything other than get you to a heart attack or a twisted ankle. So don't do it unless you want to. Don't do it because you have to. All right, I shouldn't have eaten that ice cream. Let's go in the reverse. I shouldn't have eaten that ice cream. Yes, you should. You like this argument, right? You should eat that ice cream. No, I shouldn't. High cholesterol, same thing, weight, blah, blah, blah. No, you should eat that ice cream. And here's why you should eat that ice cream. You are not eating that ice cream at 10 o'clock at night because of a nutritional need. You're eating it because of an emotional need. And if that ice cream comforts you emotionally and allows you to wind down and get a good night's sleep, eat the ice cream. It's health food. Because stress is going to kill you far faster than cholesterol. So you're allowed to eat ice cream. Now, the beauty of this is if you take the taboo away from ice cream, you don't want it as much. But you're not creating stress and anxiety by telling yourself you shouldn't have done it. SAS, fewer expectations, greater ecstasy. I happen to be blessed. The company that has hired me to do business development for them, rehab management, we do contract therapy. If you're not happy with your therapy situation, talk to me later. Only because I absolutely believe that the assisted living industry needs to evolve in this. Not because I want to sell you anything. Go to a competitor. Just learn the right way to do it. Talk to me later. I have been in healthcare my entire time, and I am tired of not that you're doing it, I'm on a soapbox here. I'm tired of the world thinking because I have business development behind my name, I'm trying to make a buck off somebody. I don't care about making a buck. I care about changing the world. I care about getting this message out there, and I'm passionate about it. I'm lucky enough that they saw my talent as a speaker, and they see that I can open doors for them, and they allow me to do this more and more and more, so I will be forever grateful for that company and very appreciative. And I lost my point, but I'm going to keep going until I find it again. But I really did lose my point. What was I talking? Oh, fewer expectations, greater ecstasy. You talk about Fiji Islands, the wonderful sand and the blue water, and you get a tsunami. So you're upset. Expectations are a curse. Do not have expectations. Goals are fine, but your one expectation in life should be joy and the opportunity and trying to improve the situation and move forward. Not that you're going to have this type of outcome or that type of outcome. I joke around all the time, and this is one of the ways that I like, quote unquote, sell from the stage without selling from the stage. I talk about fewer expectations, greater ecstasy. You know, when I knock on a door for somebody that's never seen me, I cold call, which thankfully I don't have to do anymore because I've gotten going enough that I don't have to do that anymore. But if I knock on a door, I know I'm going to get rejected. But every time I keep saying, I'm going to make a pitch, I'm going to tell them about this, I'm going to tell them we're the most wonderful company and this is the most amazing way to do it, and everybody wins and there's no cost and there's no strings attached and all this stuff, and then they won't even talk to me. So I leave upset. So I change it. Fewer expectations, greater ecstasy. My expectation now is when I'm on the cold call days, 10 times I'm going to get rejected. That's my goal. That's my expectation. If I go up and knock on 10 doors and I get rejected, that's my expectation and I'm happy. Happened to me on the third call the other day. A lady said, come on in and tell me about it. I said, no, I'm sorry. That's not my expectation. Fewer expectations, greater ecstasy. Be more aware and accepting and allowing of whatever is going to occur. I got three quick stories I want to tell you about how much of a blessing it has been for me to be in healthcare and each step along the way to learn the value of me, therefore the value of you, and be in the moment real. Everybody said, oh, you work in a nursing home. That's so depressing. It's not depressing. It's a blessing. It's one of the most beautiful environments in the world. If you look at the good, the stories I've been told, the inspiration I've received, the lessons that I lean on a daily basis from a little old man or a little old woman that didn't even talk to me until they got to know and trust me. And what an honor. I don't know why this happens every now and then. What an honor it is that they trust me and tell me those stories. And I take them every way. And I make money telling them sometimes. It's an amazing, it's not depressing, it's a blessing. The number one blessing that I learned working in a nursing home, the little old ladies taught me this, and this is an undeniable fact, I get better looking every day. That's right. A thousand women can't be wrong. And these are experienced women. They know a fine piece of man meat when they see one, I'm going to tell you. Yeah. Bunch of cougars we got down there in Kiefer, Delaware. Yeah. Every now and then they give you a little pat, you know. What was that? All of a sudden you realize you're like, whoa, when I start walking like that? You sit there and go, so when's Miss Dixon go to dinner? I mean, you think of yourself as a vibrant man, then an 88-year-old woman touches you on the butt, and you're like, whoa, there's more to life than I thought. I mean, it's wonderful. But we often dismiss these moments. You know, this is what we do. Everybody that gets in a stressful moment and needs an answer in their lives, they look in the exact wrong place. This is where we do. When I was trying to decide, am I going to leave? I ran a nursing home for 16 years. I loved it. I thought I had made a mistake when I went there, and I found a passion. I found Doc, the Defender of Caregivers. You can thank Seaford Center Nursing Home for that. I stayed there, and I thought in 2 years I need to move on. I was a single father raising kids. I needed to stay there. I thought I had failed by taking that job. I learned a life. I learned a passion. I learned my inner me. And I became Doc, the Defender of Caregivers, as a result of the people that I knew there, of what I saw them do to themselves, both good and bad. I'm getting tired. You guys are getting me worked up. So anyway, I feel so passionate to be there and these lessons that they've shared, but we still fail. When I was trying to decide, was I going to leave that and go into this venture, because it's an unknown, drive 45, 50,000 miles a year, knock on doors, get rejected, and if you don't sell, you don't get a job. You don't keep your job, you know, whatever. Was it the right thing to do? So I reached out to Bill. I went to college with Bill. I went to grad school with him. We went separate ways, but I tracked him down, and I found him because I needed something, and that's when we really find people. I needed his advice, and I needed a reference from him, and I called him, and I said, is this Dr. Horace? Hadn't talked to him in forever, and he accomplished. He was out in Arizona State University, a world-renowned PhD in econometrics, something I can't even say he's good at. And he said, is this Lonskovich? Because that was really cool back in the late 80s and early 90s. And so it was like we were never apart, you know, it's like we were never apart. And I said, Bill, I'm having a rough time. I'm trying to make this decision. I'm not sure if I'm doing the right thing. And Bill said, Lon, he said, I'm sorry for your luck. He said, dude, you should have followed me. You should have come to grad school, like I said. Dude, yeah, he called me dude twice. He calls me again, I'm hanging up the phone. I don't care how much. He goes, dude, every day I spend with 19 and 20-year-olds. They make me feel so young. So I hung up the phone and was even more depressed. I started thinking about my situation at the nursing home. Every day I spend with 92-year-olds. Awareness. Acceptance. I am young. I am young. It's awareness, acceptance, allowance. Allow yourself to have fun in the moment. Be nice to you. Be nice to you. Next story I'm going to tell you is one about Garfield. And this is about something that happens in our industry all the time. I'm almost done. I'll get you out of here. Okay, we got it. All right. I want to tell you a story about Garfield. We do this in our industry all the time. It's called surplus safety. Anybody ever heard of it? We don't know we're doing this. The very people we love and want to protect, and out of an abundance of caution, we want to make their lives better, we actually do them harm. You know what that harm is? Deep down inside, we think they're more worthy of being protected than being celebrated. They come in our buildings, and in no time, they go from a little stumble to a wheelchair, and it's such an easy progression. They come in with their families, and because the families are concerned about them and it's a new environment, they're holding onto their arm. Because you love them too, even though you don't even know them yet. You love your people before you even meet them. That's wonderful. But it also makes you and them vulnerable. They come in, you see the family holding on to them. You say, oh, maybe they got some balance issues. So we make sure that they have a quad cane. Or we make sure they have a cane. And then we realize because they're in a new environment, changing surfaces, because some of our environments are not as good as we think they are. We create problems for people with different surfaces. They look really nice on drawings, but doesn't really work. You know, and it gets the quad cane gets jammed up on the transition. So, you know, 2 days into having a quad cane, 3 days after coming in the building, now they go to a walker because it'll be safer. And you know what a walker is, right? It's a mechanical device designed to trip the elderly. Nobody uses them properly. So next thing you know, they got a walker. And then you see them almost fall with a walker because they rely on it more than they need to. And they're not used to needing anything. So now they're creating, they're making themselves more vulnerable. And then you say they're not good with the walker, they better have a wheelchair. So in no time, out of an abundance of caution and love, we take a perfectly independent person and put them in a wheelchair. You're not being bad, you're not being lazy, you're being loving. But it comes down to human potential. If you have an 18-month-old child that is trying to learn how to walk, it'd probably be a little late for, when does a kid walk? About 12? Well, you come from a hardier breed than I do. So if the kid's learning to walk and they get up and they're walking like this and then they fall, you're like, oh, he almost made it. You think nothing of it. Now, I understand there's a difference between a child falling and a geriatric person falling. But the point is, it's the human potential. We need to understand that they still have opportunities to grow. They still have vitality. They don't deserve to be protected every second of the day. They need to be able to have risks and take certain liberties. And you need to find a way to accept that into what's going on and communicate with your family so that they're aware of this. Hey, this is what we're thinking about doing. So surplus safety is a phenomenal thing. I could do a whole talk on that alone. But I want to tell you about Garfield. Garfield was, frankly, a friend of mine. Garfield was somebody that I took care of. He was a family member that ended up, I was his only caretaker, basically. And I went into an assisted living facility. I was still the nursing home administrator, but I went to visit Garfield on a regular basis. And Garfield liked to walk the grounds. Well, Garfield was starting to exhibit some dementia. And they didn't want Garfield walking on the grounds because his walks were slowly becoming a little bit longer and longer. And they were afraid that he was just going to wander off. So they wanted to restrict his walking. And I said, no. You guys are making a heck of a lot of money every month. You're going to have to come up with this. You don't need to do this. You don't need to confront him and create a big deal. You need to let Garfield take his walks, and if you're worried about him, walk with him. They wanted to have a family meeting and talk to Garfield. I wouldn't let them. I wouldn't let them. It was a mistake. Here's what happened once. I go to Garfield, and you know they did what I wanted. Family's always right, right? Well, they're not. Family's not always right. You're the experts. The family needs you. Don't be afraid to say that. You have to be quick to let go of it if they don't agree eventually, but don't be afraid to say that. So I go to visit Garfield, and he wants to go for a walk, and I could see people are frustrated. I have brand new shoes on. I was on my way to a job interview and all this stuff, but I figured I'd kill two birds with one stone and get Garfield on the way. You know, just squeeze him into a little bit. He won't know. You know, he can have my 5 minutes. I'm a good guy. He can have my 5. You know, I mean, really, wrong reasons. Distorted thinking. I go in there. I grab Garfield. We go for a walk, and sometimes Garfield would lead, sometimes he would follow, you know, sometimes we would talk and chat, sometimes he'd walk ahead like he was angry, sometimes I'd have to say, come on, Garfield, you know, so we're walking, and he's got the walker, you know, it's like this, you know what you do is a walk, you're supposed to go like this, move up to it, go like this, switch feet, my therapy department can teach you that, but no, Garfield is walking like this, you know, like he's got a divining rod and he's looking for water or something like that, right? So we're walking along, and I'm thinking, man, this just is not safe. We go around the side of the building to a service corridor, and Garfield is walking in the grass, the wet grass, with his walker. And I'm thinking, that's not safe. I sure am glad I'm here with him. Maybe I should get over closer to him. And I said, I got brand new shoes on. I'm not walking in the wet grass. So I didn't do that. I stayed there, and when you know my mind started to wander, and I went on, and I lost my train of thought, and about halfway down this service corridor, I hear, and I go, a service truck came up behind me and honked and got me out of the way. And then Garfield says, that's why I walk over here. I sure am glad you're here for me today. Garfield knows his value. Garfield's not confused. He knows his value. And here's the deal. If Garfield truly is too demented to take that walk, he's too demented to be affected by being told that in the greater scheme. If talking to him about it, if he's going to get upset and comprehended enough, he was ready for the conversation because the upsetness is comprehension at some level. And if there's no comprehension, there's no risk in having the conversation. So I did something far worse than allowing them to disrespect Garfield. I disregarded Garfield. And I did that out of an abundance of love, and it's a lesson I want you to give yourself. I want you to truly value yourself and the people you care for as much as you do in your heart. I want you to do it in your head. I want you to be aware of these things. Last story I'm going to tell you is one of the most embarrassing things that ever happened to me in my nursing career. I was working in an intensive care unit one night, not by choice or even by design. I was a med-surg nurse. I'd never worked in an intensive care unit in my life. Cognitive distortions. I was going to grad school. I had one child, another one on the way. I was going to school full-time and working full-time, and I was broke as a joke. The distortion that was going through my life was an emotional filter. I thought of everything through this. Everything in my life I thought through about money. I'm broke. Interestingly enough, I'm still doing that now. But they came to me and said, Lon, will you work in the intensive care unit tonight? And I said, will you pay me overtime? They said, time and a half. I said, I'm your man. So I walk in the intensive care unit ill-prepared for what I'm about to take on. I go in there like a 12-year-old kid walking into an arcade. Lights, bells, whistles going every ding, ding, ding. The only difference is I didn't have quarters in my pocket. And I wasn't excited. I was scared to death. I was over my head. What am I doing? I don't know how to do with any of this. I got lucky. I only had three patients.
Whoa.
Three patients in an intensive care unit. Only had three patients. One of each kind. You chew on that for a second. Yeah, one that was going to live, one that was going to die, and one that truly needed me, where I was going to make a difference in this man's life. So I have one, two, three. One, going to live, use my humor. You're out of here tomorrow. I don't need you anymore. Good job. You know, and just walk on. And then you go to number three, going to die. Would have no longer been in the unit if it wasn't the middle of the night. Going to die. Withdrawing services, what have you. Compassion, support. Is there anything I can do for you? Do you think they're okay? You know, simple thing going between these two worlds. The one that was the hardest was one in between, because this was a man about my age now. Overweight, had a heart attack. Early 50s, I'm not sure what his age was. He'd had a massive heart attack. This night was going to be a make or break for him. And I said to myself, please, Lord, don't let me do anything that's going to affect this man's outcome. Don't let me affect him, because you do this. You only focus on the things that you've not done or the things you've not done well. You don't focus on the wonderful things you've done or the many things you've done. You focus on the one mistake. That's a distorted thinking too. It's a mental filter. So I'm sitting there and it's emotional reasoning. You believe it. The more you believe it, the more emotional, the more you think it's true. Emotional reasoning. So I'm thinking, I'm going to hurt this man. Alert and oriented, watching a ball game, TV, monitor. Ding! Ding, ever present, reminding me, you're out of here tomorrow, I don't need you. Walk by, see him, check on him as I'm going by, you know. After a while, if you focus on something and look for a negative long enough, you'll find it. And if you do it persistently, people will find it for you. They'll help you find it. They'll see it. He picked up on my anxiety. Going in here, is everything okay? Is there anything I can do? Are you comfortable? Going back here again, you know. And he's like, still here. You know, so he's engaged in it. Every time I look in there, he's sitting there alert and oriented. Ding, ding, ding. Ball game on one side, TV on the other. 2-3 o'clock in the morning, we do this. We create the problems we're trying to avoid. 2-3 o'clock in the morning, I was afraid that something would happen, and I was tired. So instead of staying at the nurse's station, where I'd have to get all the way across the room, going home tomorrow is stable. Going to die tomorrow is comfortable. This is all I got to worry about. So I sit right next to the bed. I want to be there in case something happens. You know what happened? 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, I fell asleep. I'm embarrassed to admit it, I fell asleep. And I'm not talking about one of these, your chin hits your chest and bops up. I'm talking about drool coming out of the side of my mouth. I was gone. I woke up to hear what has got to be the most frightening sound you ever want to hear as a health professional. So, oh my God, what have I done? What have I done to this man? I'm a professional. I got to call out the code. I got to go through the motions. So I call out the code. I jump up on the bed and start beating on the guy's chest. All the doctors start running in the room. And then I hear, this has been a test of the emergency broadcast system. It wasn't his monitor. It was the TV signing off for the night. Okay? But then the funniest thing happens. The guy bolts straight upright in the bed. And he looks at me, he goes, what the hell are you doing? And then he says, I just checked on you 5 minutes ago. and you were resting comfortably. Now, there's a saying, if it's not written, it didn't happen. So I didn't write a note about that. But the closing lesson I want you to understand is that you think it's all about you, and it's not. But even though you think it's all about you, you don't value you, because what you do is just doing my job. It's no big damn thing. It's a big damn thing. And you're not alone. Bad things are going to happen. Be aware of that. Accept it. Allow yourself to survive it. You are amazing. The value of you and the value of yous together is something you should ever be proud of. Thank you all very much for your time.